Bally Sports Bar and Grill has all the bases covered for all those things and more. Top-notch, friendly, and attentive service. Wall-to-wall big screen TVs with all the big games. And the absolute best wings in Rapid City. Bally Sports Bar. Make it your place. 1865 Valley Drive, Rapid City.
Great news. I just got the State Farm Personal Price Plan on our home and auto insurance.
You told our agent about my thing for romance novels?
No, you don't have to get that personal. Our agent just helped me choose affordable options to create a personalized price just for us.
Oh, sweet. Then you won't believe the love triangle Jen is in now.
Contact me, State Farm agent Scott Carlson, to create your personal price plan today.
Prices vary by state. Options selected by customer. Availability and eligibility may vary.
If you're grilling this weekend, be sure to have plenty of artisan hearth buns and rolls on hand. Fancy equipment and secret sauces are great, but once you've mastered the basics, it's all about the bun. Your perfectly grilled burgers and hot dogs deserve the best, and with several varieties to choose from, including Wisconsin brat buns, gourmet brioche, French, and onion rolls, the bakers of Artisan Hearth have the buns and rolls your family will love. Artisan Hearth, locally baked, delivered fresh daily.
Save big money on everything for your painting and staining projects now at Menards. Protect your wood projects with a top coat finish from Minwax. Fast-drying polyurethane provides long-lasting protection for all types of wood surfaces, including cabinets, furniture, doors, and floors. Check out all our Minwax products in-store and online at Menards.com. Plus, view the weekly flyer for many more great deals going on now.
Save big money at Menards.
KIMM Rapid City at K294BT Rapid City. The Black Hills Sports Station. 106.7 FM and 1150 AM. Fox Sports Rapid City.
It's the deal of the day as the Buffalo Bills traded wide receiver Stephon Diggs to the Houston Texans. Now, Buffalo's going to eat $31 million of dead money on their salary cap in 2024. In return, the Bills get a second-round pick in 2025 from Houston. The Texans get Diggs, a sixth-rounder this year, and a fifth-rounder next year as part of the deal. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers have signed edge rusher Randy Gregory, while the Lions match the offer sheet from the 49ers for tight end Brock Wright. LSU's Angel Reese announced she'll enter the 2024 WNBA draft, while Caitlin Clark of Iowa was named the Naismith Women's Basketball Player of the Year. Dawn Staley of South Carolina named the Naismith Coach of the Year. Hornets head coach Steve Clifford will step down at the end of the season. He'll move to the team's front office. In day baseball, Red Sox just completed a sweep of the A's, winning in Oakland 1-0. Angels topped the Marlins 10-2 to sweep that series. Twins 7, Brewers 3. Rangers stopped the Rays 4-1.
It's time for South Dakota's Sports Talk Show. This is the Nate Brown Show, featuring live callers, live interviews, and thought-provoking sports talk. From the biggest national names to the hottest local stories, welcome to the Nate Brown Show on Fox Sports Rapid City. Here's your host, Nate Brown.
All right, welcome back in. It's a Wednesday. How are you? Thanks for checking in on South Dakota Sports Talk Show. We're live from our downtown studio, ready to go. 2 hours, thought-provoking sports talk, local, regional, national. We got you covered. The Nate Brown Show ready on Fox Sports Rapid City, and it's always a great day in the Black Hills beauty. I think the rest of the week here is going to look great. Your work week, solid stuff. Welcome in. The Nate Brown Show brought to you in part by Black Hills Urgent Care, where me and my family go to get better quicker. You can get into Black Hills Urgent Care right there at Haynes Avenue and also on Mountain View Road. That's on the west side, Bacon Park. Black Hills Urgent Care. Schedule online before you go. You can get right in. BHUCare.com. BHUCare.com. Fast, affordable, convenient. Call or walk in 7 days a week. No appointment needed. Black Hills Urgent Care, the faster way to get better. Starting on a Wednesday, welcome in on Twitter. If you're watching the show live, you can watch us there on Twitter, at Nate Brown Show. Welcome you in on there. Also there on YouTube, The Nate Brown Show, YouTube channel up and rolling. Subscribe to the channel. You've got the live show. So however you want to listen, we got you covered. Radio, digital, YouTube, Twitter, we're all over the map. All right, we're all over the show today. Really good guest lineup. I'm excited about this, so let's get to it. and then we'll get after it on the opener on this Wednesday. Justin Sell's going to join us live from Brookings, South Dakota State Athletic Director. Big news out of South Dakota State when it comes to Rapid City. So we'll get into that scene. That basketball game's going to be scheduled November 14th here at the Monument. I'm excited for it. We've talked about it this week. We'll get Justin Sell, how it all came together. And then, of course, I want to get into a lot of stuff with Justin Sell while we have him. We get him every now and then. And I appreciate his time. He's really accessible. I mean, you can tell when guys think they're big, you know, big time. And Justin's done an outstanding job, but he's always been accessible, always wants to talk to the fans out here, and we appreciate him coming on. We're going to get into the transfer portal stuff, all that stuff. Justin Sell, Athletic Director, South Dakota State, he's on the way. National college basketball writer Kerry Miller for Bleacher Report. Kerry's going to break down NCAA Final Four time and more. Kerry Miller on tap. We'll go out to Buffalo tonight. Big news, of course, with the Bills. So we got Bills writer Ryan O'Halloran, BuffaloNews.com. From Buffalo as Stephon Diggs hits the road down to Houston. Ryan O'Halloran reaction from BuffaloNews.com. Beat writer Ryan O'Halloran on the way. And Dan Swartos is going to join us live from Pier. A lot to discuss on the high school sports side with the executive director of the Activities Association, Dan Swartos, live from Pier tonight. So, quality Wednesday show, great guest lineup, and we'll make it happen with you if you want to get on the program. 720-1067 is our number as we get started. 720-1067, join us live on the studio line. Also, the Barron's Wilson text line ready to go. 720-1067, text us on the Barron's Wilson text line, and you're good to go. Okay, we're all set and out of the gate. Where do we want to start today? Couple of things, and I'm going to start with this vote down in Kansas City today. I know there's a lot of Chiefs fans around here. Are there more Chiefs fans now than there used to be? Can you guys answer me that question? I just have a feeling there's more Chiefs fans than there used to be, and we can argue about why. But there are some Chiefs fans up in this neck of the woods, and I interact with you on the show, and it's a lot of fun and the whole thing. So, Royals fans, now you got to be old school there, right? The Royals have only been good like once in a long time. So Royals fans, I don't run into them as much, but same story today. The Royals and the Chiefs tried partnering up on a new stadium down in Kansas City. Now, this is a regional story, and I think it's of interest because there's a couple of things here that I'm always interested in. What's a community going to do when it comes to owners wanting a new stadium or stadium renovations? What is a public vote going to look like? We've dealt with this stuff here in Rapid City. You and I know this. Thus the Vision Fund. How do we want to use it and all of that stuff? There's all of these arguments that are made. And we got the brand new monument and the whole thing. And people debated that back in the day, right? It was going to be huge. It was going to be a 19,000-seater. It was going to be an indoor football field. Remember the first rendition of the brand new monument? And then we voted that down. Then it comes back, and Steve Allender championed the cause and got this thing pushed through, and now we have the new monument. So there's all of these factors that factor in who's in charge, who's leading this, how is it being sold, and that's what went down in Kansas City yesterday. If you missed this, the Royals want a new stadium, and they're looking at putting it downtown, brand new stadium. So Kauffman Stadium, old stadium, it's going to be demolished is what they're looking at. Royals wanted a new stadium part of this sales tax extension. And then the Chiefs were going to get a bunch of renovations. New parking lot, new renovations to the stadium. That was going to be $800 million. And the Hunt family was going to put in $300 million of that $800. So they wanted $500 million in public funding, the Chiefs side of this. So not near what the Royals were going to get. The Royals are going to get the majority of this. They tried selling it. I followed it the last few weeks. I was going, are they going to get this done in Kansas City? What's this going to look like? They sold this as, hey, we want a new stadium, the Royals do. We want renovations, the Chiefs do. And by all accounts, as I followed it from a distance up here, they didn't really give a ton of specifics. They didn't break everything down. Here's this, here's that, here's exactly what we're going to do. And I always thought that was interesting as you go into something, because you need specifics. The public's going to look at this. They're not going to say, we'll give you the money, and then you can tell us what you're going to do. That rarely happens. They go, what are you going to do? What's the vision? How are you selling this? What's the plan? Then we might give you the money. And the reason I say that, this thing goes down yesterday in the vote. Polls closed last night. And the Chiefs fans and the Royals fans and I guess the public in Jackson County, that's Kansas City, they say no to the extension of the sales tax yesterday. They say no. I had on a guest yesterday from KC, Blair Kirkhoff, longtime sports writer, Kansas City star. He told me on yesterday's show, this is going to be tight. I told him, what's the dynamics down there? What's the feeling like? This is going to be tight. He said last time this sales tax passed, and it was 52% yes, he thought it would be right around that same number. He thought it would be. They go 58% no yesterday, 42% yes. And so now you get into this next steps thing, and people are going, well, the Kansas City Chiefs aren't going to move. And by the way, I'm going to tell you this. They will not. They're just not going to. Am I that naive to think that the Chiefs are going to lose a vote on $500 million in public funding for renovating Arrowhead Stadium, and they're just going to jump ship? I said that from the start when they started talking about this plan. The president of the Chiefs came on and said, well, we got to look at all options. You know, all options are on the table. That means he's kind of telling the fans, if we don't get this, it's going to be a bad thing. And by the way, that never works out. I see that rarely work out, meaning the owner or the president or whoever the organization says, if you guys don't do this, it's just not going to be a great thing. And then the fans and the non-fans, by the way, they really get their backs up. Oh, yeah, the Chiefs are really going to move if we don't do this. Let's call the bluff. I don't know exactly what people were thinking down there. This isn't a new tax. This is an extension of a sales tax they already voted for. This would extend it 40 years to cover the new Royal Stadium, to cover the renovations for Arrowhead Stadium. Now, the deal is this. What are the Royals going to do? I'm into the Chiefs side. NFL is king. Chiefs world champions. The whole story there. The Chiefs aren't going to screw anything up when it comes to Kansas City. People are actually saying, well, they could just go over to Kansas. Overland Park. It would be like the Overland Park Chiefs. I don't think they're going to do that. It's not like they're looking for a brand new stadium. They're going to go $500 million on renovations to Arrowhead. And they're going to start over because they lost a deal like this for $500 million? I don't think so. The Royals is the question. Major League Baseball team that has struggled. They don't make, I would assume, I don't know their books, they're not like the Chiefs, right? Their brand isn't the Chiefs. What are the Royals going to do? Kauffman Stadium's not great. They tell you it's old. They need a new stadium. Now the Kansas City Royals were the ones that never said, well, we might move. They never said that in this whole game. So they didn't go down that road. What is the next step for the Royals and Chiefs? And it brings up the big picture of, what is the public situation right now when it comes to rich owners of pro sports teams throwing out this public funding? It's not a brand new tax, so I don't think Kansas City went way over the top here. I really don't. I don't think the Chiefs and Royals went way over the top. They wanted the sales tax extended that they already had voted on, extended out 40 years. That's a long time. But it wasn't a brand new tax. So let me ask you this question as we start this Wednesday. You give me the public feel here. I want you to put yourself in KC, okay? Put yourself in KC. I don't know if you're a Chiefs fan, Royals fan, whatever it may be. You're a sports fan, I know that. So would you have voted for this extension of a sales tax to give the Chiefs the money for renovations, to give the Royals a brand new ballpark, they say downtown Kansas City? That's my question of the day. I want to start with that. If you were in Kansas City, okay, Would you have voted for the sales tax extension for the Royals and Chiefs stadiums? Their vote yesterday, I got to tell you, I thought it would come through, and I have no clue what the feeling's like in KC. I think I was following this. I think there was some negative stuff because the vision wasn't really laid out specifically. There was some threatening things being said, whether you want to say, oh, yeah, it happens, you know. Fans never like that stuff. Citizens never like that stuff. Oh, yeah, the Chiefs are saying that all options are on the table. Give me a break. And then I think there's protest votes. I think there's actually protest votes on this. We see this here in Rapid City over whatever issue we're trying to do. There's just protest votes. I'm against this. I'm against everything. So I'm just going to vote no. I'll ask you, Kansas City, you throw it out. 720-1067 is our number. 720-1067. Barron's Wilson text line or studio line. Question of the day on the Nate Brown Show as we get fired up. If you were in Kansas City, tell me which way you would have voted. Would you have said yes, sales tax extension, it's minuscule in the big picture of what it's going to cost each citizen, so to speak. We've been paying it for a long time anyway, 20 years. What's another 40 years on top of it? Would you have gone down that road? Kansas City, Jackson County voters say 58% no. I'm a little surprised by it, and I wonder if, what is that a sign of? What's that? Is it just specific to KC, bad vision, no specifics, little negative talk from the Kansas City president? Maybe that turned things around. 58% no, 42% yes. And they're passionate about their teams. I mean, the Royals, maybe not as much, but there's a long history with the Royals. People are proud to be Royals fans. I just know some of them. They're proud. It goes all the way back, going to the ballpark and for cheap and watching all the Royals games. There's a long history there. So these guys voted against it. What would you have done? That's my question as we start. Let's look at the results here. This is amazing. This is amazing on the Nate Brown Show. So I just told you, yesterday's vote, the real vote in KC was 58% no, 42% yes. The vote on our poll right now, we're very unscientific on the Nate Brown Show question of the day, but it's on Twitter. The vote is, can you guess it? 58% no, the owners can pay. 42% yes, I would have voted for it. It's not a new tax. See, here's why I'm surprised. Not only the passion of the fans there, but it was not a new tax. It was a sales tax that's going to expire, but it's not a new tax. I wonder if the Kansas City people made a mistake here. I don't know where the Royals are going to go from here. The Chiefs aren't going anywhere. Give me a break. So the Chiefs tried getting in on this because they need renovations, and they even offered up some money. Maybe they thought that would help. The Royals, they've got a new stadium that they need, and now what do they do? And by the way, in the baseball side, there's actually markets that want baseball teams. So I think people aren't looking at this in the right lens here. The Chiefs are going nowhere. They're renovating Arrowhead Stadium. That's it. The Royals and baseball markets that are ripe for the picking, there are. I mean, there's Nashville. There's places like this that want teams. And I wonder if there's something that happens with the Royals. I don't know about that. Let's see here. Listener text. Maybe we should start the campaign to get the Chiefs and Royals to South Dakota. The Chiefs end up in Sioux Falls, wouldn't they? Yeah, I mean, Sioux Falls gets everything. Let's see. Listener text. I think it was more that they were going to move the Royals downtown. People didn't want that. Is that right? People didn't want the Royals downtown. Royals and Chiefs are right next to each other. And I don't know about that. I mean, then what are you going to do with the Royals? You just to build a brand new stadium where Kauffman's at? Is that where you want to put it? I think there's even more to it. I can't believe we have the same result on the poll. Just started, 76 votes. We just threw it up there. We have the same result as the actual vote yesterday in Kansas City. 58% no, they want the owners to pay. 42% of you said you would have voted for this extension of a sales tax. Thanks for calling. You're live today, and you go ahead.
Well, I'm on a lot of them chief and royal pages.
Let me
tell you.
What do you say?
A lot of people, and I'm not saying, you know, the 50-some percent. A lot of people don't want it downtown, and they're going to vote no.
Really? Okay, what's the deal on that? What's the deal?
They just don't want it down there. They don't want it moved.
Okay.
And then throw in, they don't want to spend the money to get a stadium. They got one.
Well,
you know, that's what's funny. This is how it is now. Honestly, Royals aren't going nowhere. Neither are the Chiefs.
I know the Chiefs aren't, for sure. I would be stunned if the Royals do anything. I would be stunned.
Hoffman, he don't want to spend that money. Come on, look at our team, Nate. I can go back to 1970. Okay? We do not spend money. We did it one time. We won a World Series a few years back.
Yeah.
Look how quick that team left.
Quick. I remember that.
Because the paydays were over.
And that was kind of a surprise run by the Royals that year, if I remember. By the way, what should the Royals do then? You wouldn't have voted for this?
I would have voted yes.
Oh, you would have.
Although, then you got to look back at my other friend from South Omaha, Rosenblatt Stadium. It was downtown, not downtown, it was down on 10th Street by the Henry Dorley Zoo. Nate, we would walk 4 or 5 miles from South Omaha, well, our part of South Omaha, to go watch an Omaha Royals game. That was just, I would put it downtown, because that's where you got a lot of the working people down there.
So you would have voted for it, and you say a lot of the people say they didn't want it downtown, and that might have pushed it over the negative side. Interesting.
That could have. It's crazy.
All right, buddy.
I don't know, Nate. I like it. You miss going to Rosenblatt Stadium, I
yes,
imagine.
Yes, I've never been there.
Oh, dude. Zesty's ice cream outside. You're in an 8,000-seat arena.
I love it. I haven't been to Kauffman, by the way. I haven't been there. I've heard it's nice.
Oh, you haven't?
No.
That's not bad.
But it's old.
It's gotten better each year.
All right.
Atlanta's the place to go, Nate. $20. You get 2 large drinks.
Wow.
2 large fries, 2 hot dogs, and a pretzel, $20.
I'll take that. All right, buddy. I appreciate it. Thanks for that perspective.
All right, man.
On the KC side. So Steve's a Kansas City fan. He said he would have voted for it. And so interesting that our vote is exactly the result. I mean, I can't make this up. It's amazing. 58% on the Nate Brown Show say, I would just have the owners pay. 42% say, I would have voted for it. It's not a new tax. A lot of people, when they do this, they say, as long as it's not going to be a new tax, an extra tax, then I would do it. Kansas City didn't do it yesterday. It was going to be an extension of a sales tax that's already in place. And it's not even like ours here, the Vision Fund, which is an extra cent. I mean, this is like whatever, 3/4. I mean, it's not even that much. Not even that much. Let's see here. More results coming in. Who would be voting yes on this? So here's the dynamics. It's really easy to see. Rich owners, they get all the benefits, they make all the money, and then they want the citizens to help them do new stadiums. I really get it. And I've argued with some buddies of mine about this because people are on one side or the other. I get that sentiment, but I do believe you want to have the Royals. Like I said, I don't expect teams to leave, but it's the scenario like in Minnesota. The Vikings needed it. Well, they wanted a new stadium. You got U.S. Bank. They put that thing together. The public voted for it. The public funded it. And the Vikings owners put some money in. And then everybody gets along, and that's how it goes. it's one of those things you got to look at because it's a major impact, a sports economic impact. Huge. Just absolutely huge. I think the voters in KC yesterday, they called the bluff saying, Chiefs aren't going to move. It's renovations to the stadium. Give me a break. And I'm still seeing people not getting this. They're like, oh, the Chiefs might, oh, they could move over to Kansas. They're not moving. They wanted $500 million to renovate Arrowhead Stadium. The Royals want a brand new stadium. And it goes down yesterday. A little bit surprised by that. Okay, I want to get to this transfer thing, and I'm going to get to this next subject because a South Dakota State player, you saw him, Zeke Mayo, great player for the Jacks this past year. They win the Summit League. They go on to the tournament. Zeke Mayo's found a new home where he's going to play next year, and it is big time. He goes from South Dakota State to big time. And we just saw this happen with a North Dakota State player last year, Grant Nelson, that posts for North Dakota State. He goes to Alabama. He's playing in the Final Four Saturday night. So these guys at the mid-majors, they're getting opportunities. We're not talking just a little step up. We're talking big time. And so my deal is, what would you be doing if you're a major college basketball coach right now in this new scene of, you can get all these mid-major top-tier players, apparently, or you can look for that fight of the five-star high schoolers and get in the middle of that thing. I got to get the four stars, the five stars. Which direction is this really going from a college basketball scene? I want to get into that. I got some thoughts on it. We'll get to it. Carrie Miller's going to get going next, national college basketball writer, BleacherReport.com. He's on the way next.
You're listening to The Nate Brown Show. Follow us and watch the show live on Twitter at Nate Brown Show. Spring has sprung and riding season has officially begun at Black Hills Harley-Davidson. Find your perfect next ride with our huge selection of new and pre-owned Harley-Davidsons. You can buy a 2014 Road King for only $13,995. Or how about a 2019 Heritage 114 for only $15,995. We are stocked to the brim with a newly redesigned 2024 Street Glide and Road Glide models. And now is the perfect time to get your summer ride. Come shop Black Hills Harley-Davidson off I-90 exit 55 or online at blackhillshd.com.
Get ready to swing into spring with the $100,000 Easy Street Grand Prize Giveaway. Tin Lizzie Gaming Resort has teamed up with Elkhorn Ridge Golf Club to give away a premier golf package every Saturday in April. The package includes a couple's membership to Elkhorn Ridge, $3,000 pro shop credit, a season-long golf cart rental, and much more. Elkhorn Ridge offers a full resort experience with tennis courts, a pool, restaurant, bar, and one of the nicest golf courses in the area. Take your golf game to the next level with Tin Lizzie Gaming Resort on historic Main Street in Deadwood.
Here's your Fox Sports Rapid City forecast. Lows dip down to about 36 tonight under mainly clear skies, south winds 5 to 10 miles per hour. Tomorrow, highs around 65. 40 tomorrow night, partly cloudy. Temperatures a bit above average Friday and Saturday with highs from the upper 50s to the mid 60s. Isolated rain showers likely Saturday. That's your forecast on the Black Hills Sports Station, Fox Sports Rapid City. Right now, 61.
Only one will reign king, and you get to decide. Taste the best wings in the Black Hills at the 4th Annual King of Wings Competition. Join us at the Box Elder Event Center on April 28th as your favorite restaurants from around the area battle it out for the title of king. Sample a variety of mouthwatering flavors from classic to creative and cast your vote on the most delicious wings. Get your tickets for the King of Wings before they sell out at thebox.live.
Now through April 30th at Pumps Tire Service, get up to $100 instant savings. Save $70 when you purchase four eligible Bridgestone tires or $60 when you purchase four eligible Firestone tires. Plus, get $30 off when your purchase is made on your Pumps Tire Service credit card. Wait, there's more! Purchase four eligible tires and save an additional $40 off installation. Hurry, offers end April 30th. Pumps, we know tires and service, you should know Pumps. Subject to credit approval, see store for complete details or visit PumpsTire.com.
Nearly 150 years ago, Americans didn't race across the plains to settle. They pioneered. They toiled and ground the land into the world we know today, creating opportunities, not just for themselves, but for future generations. Don't settle. Pioneer. Pioneer Bank and Trust. Local.
Member FDIC.
Hey, it's Chris Broussard. Remember to catch the iCouple weeknights from 6 to 8 p.m. right here on Fox Sports Rapid City. And now, let's get back to Rapid City Sports Talk Show, The Nate Brown Show.
Welcome back in, South Dakota Sports Talk Show live weekdays 4 to 6. Just getting going on a Wednesday. Thanks for checking in. 106.7 FM, 1150 AM, Fox Sports Rapid City. The Nate Brown Show live. Justin Sells coming up from Brookings, South Dakota State Athletic Director. Appreciate his time. We'll have a good conversation coming up. Justin Sells on the way, SDSU AD. Kerry Miller's in first, national college basketball writer, Bleacher Report. He's on Twitter at Karrence James. Final Four Saturday. Kerry, good to have you back. How are you?
Hey, Nate, I'm doing well. Good to be on with you again.
I appreciate your time. Here we go. Final Four, and I had an interesting question from a listener yesterday, so I'm going to throw it out to you. UConn's going for back-to-back titles, and he said, can you put UConn in the category of some of the great programs? We're talking like Duke, that UNLV run, and it even said like UCLA of the 70s. I said, well, I don't think it can go there. But where's UConn stack up if they win this weekend?
Yeah, I mean, I wrote about that last year when they won a title. It was their fifth in 25 years. Like, they're already, you know, it's not a dynasty. I don't know that you can really have a dynasty in college sports outside of, you know, the UConn women have gone to like 15 of the last 16 Final Fours. Like that's a UCLA 70s men's basketball level of just absurdity. I don't think we're ever going to see that, anything close to that, in the men's game ever again. But what they've already accomplished is just absurd. And even if they don't win this weekend, like, they're already the first reigning champion to make it back to the Final Four since Florida repeated in 2007. Like, teams don't do this. That when you win a title in this day and age, your team completely breaks apart, goes pro, you know, what have you. Just to get to this point for a second straight year is kind of crazy.
How do you think they've done it when you've looked at them? I said coaching Dan Hurley's got to be really, really good. I've been told his assistants are really, really good. How do you think they've done it?
I mean, last year, like, Andre Jackson was just like that dude, you know, that bad guy nobody wanted to deal with, you know, opposing teams. Obviously, he was a great teammate. Everybody wanted him around. But for them to lose him and then bring in a guy like Cam Spencer, who is even more of just an emotional spark plug than anybody was on last year's team, like, for him to come over from Rutgers and just become that guy for them that Andre Jackson was last year, it's just so huge. And I think both of them are really an extension of Dan Hurley on the court with just that intensity, with that fire that they play with. And then, obviously, they just have a ton of talent. I mean, you got a guy like Donovan Klingon. Last year, he was coming off the bench. This year, he's saving his best for the March Madness run here. I mean, what he did against Northwestern, going for 14, 14, and 8, and then he just completely keyed that 30-0 run over Illinois in the Elite Eight. You know, obviously, Purdue has a guy who might be able to deal with Donovan Klingon, but few teams have been able to up until now.
Kerry Miller on national college basketball writer, Bleacher Report, talking UConn, talking Final Four. So I saw this. Three out of the four coaches for this weekend of the Final Four, they weren't so long ago, really. They were at the high school level. So these guys working their way. High school basketball, like Nate Oates, that wasn't that long ago. He was a high school basketball coach in Michigan. And then now he's coaching in the Final Four. What should we think of that?
I think what we think of it is it's proof that the old guard is gone, right? There's no more Coach K or Roy Williams or, you know, certainly John Calipari, Bill Self are getting up there in age. And these guys got to come from somewhere. You know, they can't all just be, you know, Coach K's right-hand man getting the job at Duke. We're going to have to hire these high school coaches. I think we've seen a lot of, you know, with like Tobin Anderson with the job that he did at FDU. You see people going the D2 route. You have a JUCO coaches. They come from all over the place, and I think that's kind of the beauty of the NCAA tournament is you've got 362 different coaching styles. They all had different backgrounds, and it just all comes together in this one crazy melting pot where anything can happen.
Kerry, would you say name, image, and likeness and the transfer portal, the combo, has helped the parity of college basketball, or is it just, yeah, there's parity?
I think it's, you know, we still got the COVID year going on. I've been, you know, mentioning that a lot. And then this year's freshman class was very weak compared to what we've seen in years past. I think that certainly played into the parity, but yeah, I mean, somebody, I think it was Jeff Goodman, was saying like 50% of all possibly eligible to return players for next season are like already in the transfer portal. I don't know if it's that high, but it's pretty crazy. Like, we're just like hitting the reset button every off season, which again is why it's so wild that Connecticut is in this Final Four again after winning it all last year. But yeah, it feels more wide open than ever. Like, there's no good reason to do a way too early top 25 right after the national championship, because everything's going to change within the next 2 months. And even from there, I mean, we're not really going to have that much of a clue what's going to happen.
We got a big transfer up here yesterday. Zeke Mayo, South Dakota State. Great player for the Jackrabbits. He had a lot of people after him. He's going to go back home. He's from Kansas, so he's going to play for the Jayhawks. And so I look at this, I go, man, so this is back-to-back years. Grant Nelson played at North Dakota State Summit League. He's with Alabama, playing in the Final Four Saturday. Now Zeke Mayo goes from SDSU, and he's going to Kansas with Bill Self. So I'm looking at it going, if I'm a coach, what's the best approach today? Is it, I'm going to go after the mid-major guys. I'm talking a big-time coach. I'm going to go the mid-major route, or I still got to fill this up with high school kids, because it looks like these big programs, Kerry, can get their pick of these mid-major guys that have proven themselves.
Yeah, it's definitely, you know, different. It feels like there's just different tiers. I mean, there are a lot of programs out there that just feel like major conference feeder schools at this point. They have a good team, and then they all disappear. We used to see that with, I remember Cleveland State. I don't know why they come to mind, but I remember like a decade ago when the transfer portal really, I don't even know if we were calling it the transfer portal back then, but it was like every time I looked around at, you know, a really good team, it seemed like they had somebody from Cleveland State on their roster. It was so weird. We used to call it a pandemic. Before the COVID pandemic, we called it the transfer epidemic. It has gotten out of control. I don't know how you handle it as a mid-major coach. Like, you almost want there to be contracts coming in the future. You want them to be employees. What's going on with the Dartmouth, the team unionizing, that might actually help the smaller schools survive all this pilfering. Because I don't really know how you go about building a program. Because, you know, even if you are successful, then you worry that your coach is going to go to the major conferences. It's tough living out there.
Do you think the big-time coaches are saying, hey, I don't need – I'm going to save a couple of spots for mid-major guys, maybe not high school fillers?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, we even saw that with John Calipari, right? You got the kid from Bucknell, Mike Muscala, like a few years ago. Antonio Reeves came from, I think, Illinois State. Like, the patron saint of going for the one-and-done freshman has – turned course and is going for these mid-major guys. And I think that really tells you kind of the direction things are going. Now, again, I think with after this coming season, the COVID year is, like, gone, right? So there won't be as much of just that oversaturation of players and talent looking for anywhere to play. But I think we may have seen kind of a full changing of the guard here over the last few years of how major conference coaches are going to build rosters.
A couple more for Kerry Miller. He's on tonight. Bleacher Report, national college basketball writer. Sunday, Duke NC State. That was the most watched college game since 2019. Big brand with Duke. NC State Cinderella run, trying to win 9 in a row. And Easter Sunday, maybe it all came together. Why do you think we had the biggest game in 5 years?
Yeah, I don't know. I thought it was interesting that that was so. I was more interested in the Purdue Tennessee game, and I grew up as a Duke fan. Like, I wanted to see what happened in that Duke game. I kind of thought of the two, you know, Duke should have won comfortably. Obviously, they didn't, but I thought that if either one was going to be a little bit ugly, I thought it would be that one. So I am surprised that was such a big game, because, you know, it's more of a regional. It's just an ACC type of game. So I don't know if that was the, like you said, the Easter Sunday thing. I can't imagine it was the Cinderella thing, right? Because it's not like the St. Peter's games last year were like the, or 2 years ago were the highest rated games ever. Like, usually the Cinderella team, they peter out the interest in them by the time we get to the Elite Eight Final Four. But I think it shows you that the game's not in as bad of a place as some of the bigger names want you to believe.
No, I'm with you on that. That was big time. I got to get your read on that other game, Purdue NC State. I think DJ Burns has been a great story. I think he has a really tough time with Zach Edey, but what do you say?
Yeah, I agree. I think maybe he'll be able to do his thing in the post on offense. If they're able to, you know, run what they did against Duke and just like clear out half the lane and let him try and, you know, deftly maneuver around Edey, maybe he can do it, because Edey's not really that, you know, eraser at the rim. He's more of a cerebral guard or defender who will sometimes block shots but make sure he doesn't get into foul trouble. So if, you know, if Burns tries to body him up, I think Edey might let him a little bit, but, you know, Burns is not the fan favorite right now because of his incredible defense. I'll put it that way. But I think Edie's going to have just a field day if they let him. You know, Ben Middlebrooks will come off the bench and he'll probably commit five fouls in about 8 minutes, and then they'll be right back to Burns again.
Yeah, that's going to be a tough one for Middlebrooks too. He's been an energy guy, but I'll tell you, Edey, 7'4", 300 pounds. Look out. I've got Purdue UConn. That was my initial pick. Kerry, give me a little credit. I mean, my whole bracket's not great, but I do have Purdue UConn. I really went out on a limb.
Yeah, I had I had UConn Tennessee, so whatever.
Okay.
My bracket was gone a while ago. But yeah, I mean, this is what we thought the championship was going to be. Obviously, I didn't personally pick it in my bracket. I don't know why I ended up taking Tennessee. I think I was convinced that Dalton Connect was going to score like 60 points on Fletcher Lawyer. He almost did. He scored 37.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, early in the year, right, Purdue, they won the Maui Invitational. They went through Marquette, Tennessee, and Gonzaga. They beat Alabama and Arizona early. They won five non-conference games against Sweet 16 teams. Like, they were the team to beat early in the year. We just kind of forgot about that for a while. They've been very good. And if we get that championship game, it's going to be, you know, right up there with the Baylor-Gonzaga game from a couple of years ago, where it's going to be – you know, KenPom number one against KenPom number two, and it'll be awesome. We'll see if Alabama or NC State has anything to say about it, though.
It's interesting. Some people say Alabama might be able to give UConn a little bit of trouble. Nobody has been able to do it in the tournament. Kerry Miller on tonight covering the tournament for Bleacher Report, national college basketball writer. He's on Twitter at Karrence James and BleacherReport.com. Kerry, always great. Thanks for your time.
You got it. Take care, Nate.
Appreciate it. Kerry Miller tonight on Fox Sports Rapid City. Follow his work, Bleacher Report, national college basketball writer here on the Nate Brown Show. All right. Good stuff on the college basketball side. So let me ask you this question, okay? I love questions. We love the question of the day on the Nate Brown Show. Let me ask you this. If you were a big-time head basketball coach, you are Bill Self. You're Bill Self. Would you just wait and for the transfer portal, you know, you got to save a couple of spots here, wait for the mid-major stars like Zeke Mayo at South Dakota State, who the Jayhawks just got? Would you just wait, or are you still going to get in that, you know, we're going to go best five-star? I mean, we're Kansas. We're Duke. We're going to go five-star high school guys. Like the kid Flag, who's coming to Duke, right? Number one player. We're going to still go get those guys. Or are you going to get a guy that's been freshman, sophomore, now he's looking good? Grant Nelson, North Dakota State. Now he goes to Alabama. He's an impact player. He's in the Final Four. How would you approach that? I'm going mid-major transfers. I'm going best of the best high schoolers. But you got to really look at this thing. Zeke Mayo was playing in Brookings at South Dakota State. Obviously, they missed him. I mean, how do these coaches miss these guys this bad? If Zeke Mayo can go to Kansas and they're after him and he's going to play right away in the Big 12 for the Jayhawks next year, man, what a big miss on the recruiting trail. So now you look at it and say, hey, if I miss here, I can go to the mid-majors. I know how good these guys are now, and I'm going to go get a more mature guy and bring him in then. Sure seems like that's what some of these guys are doing. I ask you which way you would go, mid-major transfers, or you could get the best high schoolers in the country. 720-1067, the Barron's Wilson text line. Give me your read. We're going to go to Justin Sell. Lot to discuss with the athletic director for the South Dakota State Jackrabbits, and he joins me live from Brookings next.
Did you miss an interview or great segment on The Nate Brown Show? Just find The Nate Brown Show podcast and listen wherever you download your podcast.
The wait is over. Ensemble entry doors exclusively from Renewal by Anderson have arrived with an incredible offer. Secure, timeless style, elegant features, customized countless ways with the legendary quality of Renewal by Anderson. Right now, you get 20% off every Ensemble entry door. No money down, no interest, and no payments for 12 months. No payments for a year. Please scan the QR code on your screen or visit rbarapidcity.com now to book your free estimate. Ensemble entry doors, the wait is over.
We are number one, so you can always be their number one. Black Hills Surgical Hospital and Black Hills Orthopedic and Spine Center. The number one hospital in the nation for major orthopedic surgery.
Hi, this is Dr. Dan Jensen at Physio. We want to be your trusted partner for physical therapy, athlete development, and sports rehab. As the official strength and conditioning partners for Stevens, Central, Douglas, and the Rapid City Rush, our team at Physio is building the best athletes in the Black Hills. If you have an athlete in the family, we offer long-term athlete development at affordable prices for middle and high school students. We also have the only board-certified sports PT in Rapid City. At our brand new facility, Physio is ready to help you perform at your best. One-on-one physical therapy, athlete development, and sports rehab, all at one place. Get started at bhphysio.com.
Are you thinking about starting or expanding a business? At Black Hills Federal Credit Union, our dedicated business lending team focuses on understanding our members' unique needs and truly wants to help them succeed. From the loans to get your business off the ground to the accounts to keep it running, we offer unique products with your business's best interest in mind. Learn more at bhfcu.com or text or call 605-718-1818. BHFCU is a member-owned, not-for-profit.
Hi, this is David Brenneman with Coldwell Banker, Black Hills Legacy in Rapid City. With today's home values, right now could be a great time to sell your home. The Black Hills housing market is competitive, and I would love to help you get top dollar for your home. I have been selling real estate and attracting buyers in Rapid City for nearly 20 years. When it comes to buying or selling, experience matters. If you're thinking of selling your current home, let me put my expertise to work for you. Just Google David Brenneman, Coldwell Banker. List it, sell it, and move on. With me, David Brenneman, Coldwell Banker.
When it comes to protecting your home and your belongings, what works for your neighbor most likely won't work for you. Insurance is personal, and that's why the coverage specialists at Fisher Rounds and Associates work with you to tailor a policy that protects your family, home, auto, and other valuable possessions at the most reasonable cost possible. We sweat the small and the big stuff, so you don't have to. That's at your service, at your side. Fisher Rounds and Associates, with offices in Pierre, Mitchell, Rapid City, Sioux Falls, and Watertown.
Hi, it's Colin Coward. Great to be in the Black Hills. Getting the herd weekdays 10 to 1 on 106.7 FM and 11.50 AM Fox Sports.
Welcome back in, South Dakota Sports Talk Show, live weekdays 4 to 6 on Fox Sports Rapid City. A lot of ways you can listen here in the Black Hills on the radio, 106.7 FM, 11.50 AM. Anywhere you can stream us, foxsportsrapidcity.com. Live stream us on your phone. And, of course, welcome in studio. You can watch the show live digitally
on YouTube, The Nate Brown Show. Search for it, subscribe, you got us, The Nate Brown Show on YouTube and on Twitter, at Nate Brown Show. Follow the show and watch us live. We'll go out to Buffalo coming up. Bills beat writer Ryan O'Halloran on the way. Buffalo news straight ahead. Stephon Diggs on the move again, so we'll get into that. Ryan O'Halloran live from Buffalo straight ahead. Also on the high school side, we'll go to Pierre. Dan Swartos, executive director of the Activities Association, was big athletic director meeting. And we'll go through some of the topics with Dan Swartos on the high school side. Hey, big news. I've been talking about it since they announced it. November 14th. It's a Thursday night. The Summit Arena at the Monument. I said, man, we got to embrace this. We got to promote this. The city has to embrace it. And we got to put on a great showing as South Dakota State basketball comes to play in Rapid City against Northern Colorado. So I'm ready. Athletic director for the Jacks, Justin Sell. Always good to have him on the Nate Brown Show. Justin, good to have you. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. Always good to catch up with you, Nate.
Well, I appreciate your time. I know you're busy. I say you're always accessible, so I appreciate that. And big news in Rapid City, so I wanted to start there. We've been looking at this for a while, and I've been talking to the Rapid City Sports Commission, and people are wondering, hey, can Rapid City get a D1 basketball game? And you guys decide to step in that, and it's going to be South Dakota State men's basketball against Northern Colorado November 14th. A lot of moving pieces, I know. So why'd you go down this road?
Yeah, well, like you said, we have been talking for quite a few years. We've obviously had some wrestling out West River, but it's such an important place for us with so many great alums. I know for our president, Barry Dunn, and our institution, it's a big deal. And to have an opportunity to connect with an important part of the state and then certainly showcase some great basketball, and it's a good alternate site. It's hard to get teams always to come to Frost as well. And you noted, and there are so many factors in scheduling, especially men's basketball, but to have some of those things come together and have a school that's willing to join us and kind of showcase it out there, we're super excited. And, you know, hopefully we can get women's basketball out there. Hopefully we can get wrestling back out there. But we'd love to be more regularly out in the Rapid City area.
Well, I appreciate you making it happen. And a lot of people had to put some work into it. And you guys, like I said, it would be a home game for you. So you're going away from Brookings. You're coming out here. The impact of that is you just want to, I assume, hey, the Jacks are statewide. How important is Rapid City?
Yeah, it's extremely important. I mean, we obviously come out every summer, at least from a university and athletic department standpoint, together in the middle of July. And obviously our university is out there quite a bit from academic programs and nursing. President Dunn's out there a lot. And when the rodeo's out there, we got people out there. And it's just there's a natural connection. It's a great place and place to be in our state. And I'm really appreciative of the Sports Commission and the folks there over the years have always stayed in touch and tried to figure out how can we make these things happen. And obviously, as facilities have changed and the opportunity to do some bigger things as well, just one of those things that has been a priority and that we're just really happy and proud that it came together.
South Dakota State men's basketball against Northern Colorado, November 14th. We'll be talking about it a lot. I'm going to hope the city gets behind this. Going to need some promotion. I want to put on a big crowd for you guys. The Jacks deserve that. So it'll be November 14th, Summit Arena at the Monument, Jackrabbit basketball out here West River. Let me get into the overall landscape here. You guys have had another strong showing in hoops. Women go to the tournament. Men, they win the Summit League. I mean, it's looking like, hey, you guys are just perennial powers out there. Talk about the women's program to start. Coach AJ just keeps getting it done.
Yeah, you know, I think that's one of the points of pride for our institution and certainly our athletic program. We want broad-based success, and we want a chance to do it year after year after year. And there's a different approach that comes in if you're going to win in the long term and win the long game. And AJ, obviously being here 22 or 3 years and is a leader in that program, the guy is a genius when it comes to putting together rosters and knowing how to get the best out of them. We certainly had some injury challenges and things that he probably hasn't faced at this level in his time here, and he did just an amazing job putting it together. And I don't know, we're up to 46 or 7 straight wins in the Summit League. You know, obviously back-to-back NCAA appearances, and probably have maybe the best recruiting class we've ever had coming into the fall. And so I think expectations are high. And then women's basketball on the national scene is just blowing up. The last few years, it's continued to grow. And what a great time to be good at women's basketball.
Justin Sell on South Dakota State Athletic Director talking Jacks. The men make the tournament, and then the matchup against Coach Otzelberger. I mean, you got to pull some strings, Justin. Yeah, Eric Henderson had to take on his buddy.
Yeah. It's I joke, TJ, finally they'll play us.
Yeah.
You know, it's usually crickets when we call Coach McDermott or TJ. But no, they're great friends. Been great to us in terms of their impact on this program. And certainly Coach Henderson working with both of them, and there's a lot of influences, and there's a reason those programs are successful. These guys know how to win, and it's always a little strange playing friends. At the same time, you know, it's an NCAA tournament, and you got an opportunity. TJ had a fantastic team this year, and obviously they got off to a really fast start with us, and they were a handful, but what a great experience.
Okay, so Coach Eric Henderson's done a great job. That program continues to do so well, and it's in the face of some challenges here. I look around the Summit League, Justin, you know this, the first team all-conference guys, they all went to the transfer portal. All first team in the Summit League. That seems like it's even happening more. That's a big challenge. How do you talk to your coach about that?
Yeah, well, I think first, having great relationships, you know, the ability to adjust, the ability to define what makes success. And for us, yeah, we want to win. That's part of it. Part of it is creating a great experience where kids have an opportunity to get a degree that is meaningful and worthwhile to them. And then being able to manage through, you know, in our world right now, with Summit League basketball, and for us at South Dakota State, we've got to find that core of guys, the Matt Mims and the Charlie Easleys, and we've had those guys in years past that are from this area, will love to put the Jackrabbits on their chest, and they'll die for us. And then you're going to have to manage a little bit of roster transition. It's just the way it's going, and it doesn't mean that those kids that are getting that other opportunity aren't loyal or aren't great Jackrabbits. They did great things for us. Baylor and William Kyle and certainly Zeke were great Jackrabbits, and they moved our program forward. You know, we're also getting an opportunity to maybe recruit a little higher high school kid that we maybe couldn't have gotten years past because the big schools are focusing on those that we're developing. And so you just have to get comfortable with knowing we've got to get some of those kids, we've got to develop them, and then you got to put a few pieces around that fit with what we're trying to do here at SDSU. And so while it's challenging, we actually embrace the opportunity to figure those things out, and I think we've done that as well as anybody over the years, hence the opportunity to be in the chase and win the league.
Is that a real thing, Justin? You're in the middle of college athletics. The big-time programs waiting, kind of hanging on here of, well, we can maybe get some of these mid-major stars that are mature and that have developed and that have shown they can compete. Is that very real every year now?
Yeah, I mean, I think it started several years ago and maybe wasn't so blatant. I think it's blatant now. I think it's a strategy for especially the Power Five to gain some kids that have experience. You know, Nate, we've always talked over the years, one of our advantages getting into the tournament is typically we were old, and you're playing a lot of schools that have a lot of freshmen and sophomores playing, and they may be extremely talented, but they may not have the experience, and that was a great equalizer. The shift now and what makes it really difficult is I think there's two things. One, they've now gotten old, because they're taking kids that have played a lot of minutes and been at a maybe first team all-league level or for Zeke player of the year, and they're able to get those kids and supplement the roster in that way. And so that's one challenge. The other is, how do we as a Summit League continue to improve our programs across the board so we aren't in the 15 and 16 game every year. We got to get that seed line up so we have chances to be more successful in the NCAA tournament. So there's kind of a dual effect to that, and we're trying to kind of in real time figure out how to put some of those things together.
Jackrabbits Athletic Director Justin Sell on tonight. One more, and I'll let him run. He's coming out. The Jacks are playing Northern Colorado in Rapid City November 14th. This next basketball season, we'll be there and ready to go. I wanted to promote that, and we'll be heavy on it. Speaking of the tournament, Jacks make it. I've seen people talking about, Justin, maybe this tournament gets bigger. I've seen Big 12 commissioner, some of these Power 5 commissioners here. The tournament could get bigger. Does that mean Summit League always has a spot, do you still believe?
Yeah, well, first off, I'm not sure bigger is better in the case of the tournament. You know, it's a very proven tournament. I think there's been talk about, you know, looking at the auto bids. I think it would be a huge mistake to walk away from that. That's really where you get those interesting matchups, especially in the first weekend of the tournament. You know, and I find it interesting. You've got some of these big-time coaches talking about maybe we don't deserve an auto bid, and yet they won't play us, you know. And so, you know, if they're that good and they're that far superior, then play us in the non-conference. If you're not willing to do that, I have a hard time saying we should be giving up an auto bid. And so we have the deck stacked against us in about every possible way. And yet we can put competitive teams on the floor, and we've proven that here at SDSU for the last 12 or 13 years. So we've done it for an extended period of time. It would be a shame if some of those opportunities are taken away.
Justin Sell tonight breaking down Jacks Athletics, a national football championship. Both women and men make the tournament. I saw wrestling just off the charts. I mean, unbelievable success in wrestling this year. Justin Sell, South Dakota State Athletic Director. Always great to have you, Justin. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, thanks, and looking forward to seeing everyone out this summer and then certainly in the fall for the basketball game. I appreciate you, Nate.
I appreciate you coming on. We'll pump that thing up. I think it's important. Jacks haven't been out here in a long time. We've been looking at it. They've been looking at it. It's not an easy thing. Okay, you got to look at the schedule. Okay, what type of game could we do here? Can we meet in the middle with somebody? And they got it done. Rapid City Sports Commission got it done, and the Jacks in Northern Colorado. So that'll be Rapid City November 14th. We'll pump that up. I think it's important. I said we got to get a lot of folks there. It's going to be at a great facility. We can't just treat it as it's a game Thursday night, right? No, I mean, this has to be an event, so we'll do our part on that. South Dakota State coming out to play Northern Colorado November 14th. Jackrabbit Sports in good shape. Justin Sell on tonight, athletic director for the Jacks. Let's go out to Buffalo. Ryan O'Halloran on the way. BuffaloNews.com. The latest on Stephon Diggs. Was it a big loss for the Bills? Next.
From high school to college to the pros, this is the Nate Brown Show on 106.7 FM and 1150 AM Fox Sports Rapid City.
Looking for a career? Look no further. Pete Lean & Sons has immediate openings for ready-mix concrete delivery drivers. No CDL? No problem. We offer paid training, competitive hourly rates, and full-time hours. Plus, Pete Lean & Sons offers excellent benefits, including a low-deductible health insurance plan and a 401k with a generous company match. At Pete Lean & Sons, team members can also grow and develop their trade while supporting local communities. These are all reasons why employees hired at Pete Lean & Sons want to retire at Pete Lean & Sons. Apply now at PeteLean.com.
Warn Chemical and Equipment Company has a five-step lawn care program to make your lawn the best it can be. Let Warn take care of your lawn weeds, plus five applications of fertilizer and micronutrients for a green, healthy lawn. We also offer lawn aeration to help your lawn breathe. Warn's five-step lawn pro service is the original lawn service company in Rapid City. Single applications of weed and feed or just lawn weeds are also available. Call Warn Chemical and Equipment Company for an estimate on our five-step lawn care program for your lawn. Phone 342-7644.
Here's your Fox Sports Rapid City forecast. Lows dip down to about 36 tonight under mainly clear skies, south winds 5 to 10 miles per hour. Tomorrow, highs around 65. 40 tomorrow night, partly cloudy.
Temperatures a bit above average Friday and Saturday, with highs from the upper 50s to the mid-60s. Isolated rain showers likely Saturday. That's your forecast on the Black Hills Sports Station, Fox Sports Rapid City. Right now, 61.
Hi, it's Nate Brown for Black Hills Community Bank. If you run your own company or you're looking to start a small business here in the Black Hills, you want to make sure you choose the right banking partner. And I know the right choice for business is Black Hills Community Bank. They have plenty of banking options to suit your specific needs. And Black Hills Community Bank is here to help business owners thrive and to make sure you have the support and tools to help your business grow. Just contact one of their business loan experts today or visit bhcbank.com. Member FDIC.
Live from the Anytime Auto Sales Service and Details Studio, sales, service, and recreation, this is Fox Sports.
Good stuff tonight on a Wednesday. The Nate Brown Show live, 106.7 FM, 11:50 AM, Fox Sports Rapid City. Your sports, your show, from local, regional, national. We got you covered. We're going to go out to Buffalo. Big news out of Bills territory today. Stephon Diggs on the move to the Houston Texans. Did the Bills want to get rid of Stephon Diggs? They get a second-round pick next year. They gave up a little bit to the Texans after that as well. Going to eat some dead cap money. What's the story here? Ryan O'Halloran covers the Bills and the Buffalo sports scene, of course. BuffaloNews.com for the coverage. BuffaloNews.com. You can follow Ryan on Twitter at Ryan O'Halloran. He's back on the Nate Brown Show. Ryan, how are you tonight?
Hey, Nate. Good to join you.
I appreciate your time, man. Busy day, so thanks for hopping in. My first question, did the Bills want to get rid of Diggs?
Well, today, so they did, because they traded him for a draft pick that's not in this year's draft. They were fine absorbing a $31 million dead cap hit. They were fine with doing it this late, where a number one receiver is currently not under contract. And they did it because they're fine doing it because the production wasn't meeting the drama anymore. He was a player in decline. He had one touchdown over the last 10 games last year. And I think right now it's move on from him now. Bite the pain of the dead cap hit this year, and his money is off the books for 2025.
Some people reacted to it saying, you're gonna let him go to the Texans? What are you doing?
Well, I think that if you had to rank the surprises of today, the first one was that there was a deal. The second one is you're really trading within the conference and to a team you may have to go through on your way to the Super Bowl. It also shows you what they think of him as a player. So, you know, you don't know how many suitors they had. I asked Brandon Bean, the GM, earlier today, did Diggs' camp demand a trade? He hemmed and hawed. Well, to me, it's at very least a mutual agreement that these sides needed to part.
Why do you think Diggs had, I don't know, maybe some drama there, meaning sometimes unhappy? It felt like he got along with Josh Allen, and then there was a little drama. I'm not plugged in as much, but it is looking from the outside. It's like Diggs not totally happy. Was it the offense? Well, the OC got fired, and is he still not happy? What's the story?
Well, let's put it this way. Each of his 4 years in Buffalo, he had at least 154 targets. Each of his years in Buffalo, he had at least 103 catches. Each year, he had at least 8 touchdowns. So, if anything, Josh Allen was force-feeding Stephon Diggs to keep him involved, to get him involved early in the game. I just think Diggs wore out his welcome. 5 years in Minnesota, 4 years in Buffalo. It's what some receivers just do. It's never good enough. They're never going to be happy. And I do think that Joe Brady, when he took over as coordinator, Stephon Diggs is not a bubble screen guy. He needs to be moving north. He needs to be moving down the field. And, you know, when his per-catch average is 11.1, which is his lowest since 2016, that suggests he's not getting open downfield. So, you know, are the Bills better today than they were yesterday? No. But they basically admitted today, their Super Bowl window is still open, and they feel they can get there without Stephon Diggs.
Okay, Ryan O'Halloran on tonight from Buffalo, covers the Bills. BuffaloNews.com. He's here on the Nate Brown Show. Stephon Diggs traded to the Houston Texans today. So do you think that they had conversations with Josh Allen about this?
Well, that was asked earlier today, and what Brandon Bean said is that Josh was alerted that something could be cooking. He had not talked to Allen today since the trade was agreed upon. You do keep your quarterbacks in the loop, just like I would hope they keep in the loop when they're looking at receivers in this draft, which I think they're going to take one at 28, or they move up or down. So that was the story we got. I think you do run this stuff past the quarterback because it's that important of a player.
Okay, I saw you tweet this out. I think this is the number 20 of the 53 players the Bills had in this last game of the season in their loss in the playoffs. 20 of the 53 are gone or not re-signed. That's a big number. What's happening here? People are wondering, are they going to compete? Are they rebuilding? This seems odd.
Yeah, and I used the term last week from the league meeting, is they are resetting in 2024, so they don't have to rebuild in 2025 and beyond. I still think that applies even after moving Diggs. You know, they knew March of 24 was going to be painful as far back as March of 23. They put all their eggs in the Super Bowl basket, and then I think they've made the right course. Is, hey, this group, let's face it, Nate, this group has underperformed. I mean, they felt this team was built for a Super Bowl. And they've lost home divisional playoff games the last 2 years. That means you're not moving forward. So I think they needed to shake the decks. They needed to do it significantly this offseason instead of pushing money down the line with older players. Maybe move on from older players a year early before instead of a year late. The Diggs thing, I think, is a bonus, or else they would have, you know, done this last month when the league year opened. But I still think they're the top team in the division.
Okay, so you talked about are they better than they were? Probably not. I'm looking at the wide receivers. They don't have great wide receivers. You say, well, I think they're going to get one of the draft. I mean, maybe you can get a great one. I don't know. That maybe has to be the plan. This wide receiver core doesn't look great.
The Bills, it's on paper. It's unproven. Curtis Samuel just got here. Mac Hollins just got here. Khalil Shakir is a third-year player who emerged down the stretch last year as a more reliable option than Stephon Diggs. But I think one of the two main takeaways is if you're a Bills fan looking toward the future, is one, receiver's a priority in the first round. Somebody who can, you know, has a speed element. And I think the biggest thing today is this passing game right now goes through Dalton Kincaid, the second-year tight end. You started to see that late in the year when the team got on a winning streak. He just has to score more touchdowns. But, you know, he has the trust of Josh Allen. So, you know, they wanted to be a 12-personnel team last year. Then Dawson Knox got hurt. I still think they're committed to that for this year. And so two receivers, two tight end, one back. So you draft a guy, you maybe see a step forward from Shakir, and then you have Curtis Samuel as a, you know, sort of a jack-of-all-trades. You know, I think if you're Josh Allen, you should be a little liberated by this today, because you know, Stephon Diggs was a high volume player. Now you can maybe, you know, just sort of operate within the framework of the offense more often.
Interesting. So, put your NFL hat on, Ryan. Diggs goes to the Texans, and all I hear on National Sports Talk today is, well, the Texans are they're the real deal now. I'm not sold on that, but am I missing it?
No, because they're the flavor of the season, just like Detroit was this time last year. The Lions rewarded people's confidence on that. You know, you look at the Jacksonville Jaguars in the AFC South last year. We're talking about them in the same way that we're talking about the Texans right now, except C.J. Stroud is a better quarterback than Trevor Lawrence. So, I mean, that Texans still have some work to do. You know, and also they're going to have to deal with their name and lights for the first time in a long time. That takes an adjustment. So I do think they're the top team in the AFC South, but I wouldn't put them in the category of Buffalo, Cincinnati, Kansas City, Baltimore just yet.
Diggs gone from Buffalo. I didn't see it coming. Ryan O'Halloran covering it, BuffaloNews.com. Follow him on Twitter. Good follow at Ryan O'Halloran. Ryan, always great, man. Thanks for coming on.
Okay, Nate, anytime now.
Appreciate it. Ryan O'Halloran in tonight. Covered the Broncos down there for the Denver Post, and now covers the Bills out in Buffalo for the Buffalo News here on the Nate Brown Show on Fox Sports Rapid City. I asked Ryan, point blank, So the Bills get rid of Stephon Diggs. I mean, they get rid of, they got to have a dead cap hit there. That's pretty significant. I mean, it's pretty significant, guys. And then you send him to the Texans in the conference. So I'm looking at it going, Diggs is, has he just been a problem? I mean, I watch a lot of Buffalo Bills games with my boy Josh Allen. So I watch a lot of Bills games. It just, I mean, I don't know the guy at all. You don't know what happens behind closed doors. He just seems like a problem, right? I mean, these guys, there's just some of them. There's just a few of them. And they just seem like a problem. And I put them in the same category like Terrell Owens. You know, Terrell Owens and some of these wide receivers that just can't quite, nothing's ever quite good enough. I mean, you got to look at it. Stephon Diggs was playing with Josh Allen. Second best quarterback in the league, could we say that maybe? Behind Mahomes, your boy. So I would say you got Josh Allen. It's been high production. It's been high volume, high production, and it's still just not quite good enough for some reason. I just don't get it. Listener text coming in here on, and the same story is, he was at Minnesota. It was the same kind of thing. Now, he didn't have Josh Allen there, but same kind of thing. Just wasn't happy in Minnesota either. Listener text coming in, 720-1067. Diggs is a cancer. I don't know why an up-and-coming team like Houston would take him. If he doesn't get the ball, he's a baby. kind of. Is Diggs going to impact C.J. Stroud is my question. I mean, C.J. Stroud, just a rookie last year. Came on the scene, had a great year, and now you got Diggs out there. You got to spread it around. Can I throw it to Tank Dell, or do I have to get it to Diggs? I mean, it's Ryan O'Halloran said it best. Does this liberate Josh Allen to be he's now the full-on leader. I'm running the show. I don't have to worry if Stephon Diggs is going to throw a fit. I really wonder that. Listener text, as a Vikings fan, Diggs is a freaking diva. I know. I just don't get it, these guys. I don't get some of the personalities. There's a few of them. So let's get into the drive at 5 tonight on the Nate Brown Show with this headline. Now, this is a big one, and I have no clue if they're trying to scare us or what. This just came out. College presidents have devised already a super league for college football. College presidents have devised a super league for college football already. And the last part, they say, the presidents believe the current system we're in is doomed and headed for bankruptcy. we'll bite that one off next.
You're listening to The Nate Brown Show.
Save big money on everything for your next project now at Menards. Check out our huge selection of Richmond water heaters. Whether it's electric, gas, or you're even thinking tankless options, Menards has what you need in stock. Ensure that you have hot water for when you need it most with a new Richmond water heater from Menards. Explore our entire selection of Richmond water heater options in store or online at Menards.com.
Save big money at Menards.
Do you have a financial game plan for your life? Hi, this is Lee Cruz, your local trusted New York Life agent here in Rapid City. My passion is helping you put the pieces in place for your family to make sure your game plan is a success. For over 175 years, New York Life has been helping people like yourself take action in securing their future. Don't wait, take action and Google Lee Cruz New York Life or call 605-360-8804. We will work together on putting your family first.
Kelley Blue Book Instant Cash Offer from Denny Menholt Toyota. Use your phone. It's fast and easy. Pull up our website, click on Value Trade-In, scan your VIN, and tell us about your car. You are on your way to a no-hassle, no-commitment cash offer on your vehicle in under 5 minutes. Bring your vehicle and your Kelley Blue Book Instant Cash Offer to Denny Menholt Toyota and get cash or trade-in credit today. See you soon at Denny Menholt Toyota, Rapid City.
KIMM Rapid City and K294BT Rapid City. The Black Hills Sports Station, 106.7 FM and 1150 AM. Fox Sports Rapid City.
Whether you run the race, make the catch, cast a line, pitch a tent, or just look good doing it, Shields Rapid City has your gear. From athletic clothing from your favorite team, cold weather gear to keep you warm, to the best camping selection this side of the Black Hills, and the most stylish and functional women's outerwear and footwear, Shields has the widest selection of the best brands in the business. So when you're ready to get out, get in the game, or get going, get to Shields. Shields, we're right there with you at Rushmore Crossing in Rapid City.
Ever wish you had a take-back? Highmark Credit Union is pleased to offer innovative loans with take-back. Most banks and credit unions make you choose between paying ahead on a loan or saving for emergencies. We do things differently. At Highmark, you can have both. Access the cash you paid above your monthly minimum whenever you need it. Make the smart money move. Highmark Credit Union. Highmark. FCU.com.
Are you looking to make a positive change? Then look no further. Profile Plan Rapid City works with you to create a custom plan to help guide you to your nutrition, activity, and lifestyle goals. Taking a scientific and evidence-based approach to healthy lifestyle change, Profile Plan certified health coaches meet you where you're at and develop a personalized plan that's simple, effective, and sustainable. Schedule a free consult today at profileplan.com/rapidcity or just stop by their location next to LabCorp on Omaha Street.
Hi, this is Dan Patrick. Remember to catch me weekday mornings from 7 until 10 a.m. right here on 106.7 FM and 1150 AM Fox Sports Rapid City. And now, back to Rapid City's sports talk show, the Nate Brown Show.
Welcome back in. The Drive at 5 on a Wednesday. The Nate Brown Show live on Fox Sports Rapid City. The Drive at 5 brought to you by Summit Automotive Group. Pre-owned selection, really good. Take a look on your phone. Easy right there right now. SummitAutoGRP.com. If you're in the market for pre-owned, top quality and the Summit difference, car buying built around you from start to finish, get in touch with the folks at Summit. Stacy and Matt, outstanding job. SummitAutoGRP.com. You won't be let down there. Take a look what they have and then experience the Summit difference. SummitAutoGRP.com. And the Drive at 5. Dan Swartos coming up from Pier, Executive Director of the Activities Association. I want to get into high school topics, a lot of them that were discussed at the Athletic Directors Conference. All the ADs from the state just met up. They went over a lot of stuff. I want to get into that. Dan Swartos coming up from Pier. I want to get into this right now because it just came out. And so this has been discussed, but I didn't know that there was actually a plan. And you got to keep an eye on these guys. You got to keep an eye on this. So this just came out from The Athletic, Andrew Marchand. And he's doing reporting on this, saying that college presidents have been already putting a plan together, and they've devised a plan for a Super League of college football. So the initial thought here is, well, eventually, there's just so many powerful teams, and the Big Ten's taking over, and the SEC's taking over. They're just going to have their own league. I get it. I think that's where we're going. But this out today from The Athletic says the college presidents have devised already the Super League. And they're looking at 80 teams. So they're looking at 80 teams. Here's some of the things that would be a part of this Super League. No more conferences as we know them now. No more conferences as we know them. Playoff berths would be decided on the field, they say. It wouldn't be, well, this automatic berth for a conference and this automatic berth. They say, no, none of that. Then they say if you're in this category of the 80 teams and maybe you're on that bubble, they're looking at a promotion and relegation for some of the smaller programs. Promotion and relegation for some of the smaller teams. And then they go down this road. Where does NIL fit in here? The NCAA doesn't have any regulation on NIL right now. They think they do. They don't. So this Super League run on its own. Players would be paid directly, and NIL would be really managed along with the transfer portal. So this college football Super League is already devised. There's people actually not just throwing stuff out and hoping it sticks. They have a plan. Now, they say, well, we're going to regulate NIL. We're going to pay the players, but we're going to regulate. It's going to be a regulated deal here. We're going to regulate the transfer portal as well, and we're going to make sure that the playoff berths, well, you know, we don't have to worry about this conference and that conference now. And then you know what they say in this? This article goes on and says, the current system is doomed, and it's facing bankruptcy. Okay, so that got my attention. The current system's doomed, and it's facing bankruptcy. What do you think that means for the biggest programs in college football? To me, that sounds like the big power leagues don't want to share money with the other teams. I'm just guessing, okay? We got our own Super League. We're going to do our own thing. Right now, all the power conferences and the college football playoff as it's designed, 14 teams, when they get there, we're going to start with 12, then we're going to go to 14. We have to share money with all these programs. So we're headed, this is doomed. This system is just not going to work because we got to pay all these players. We got all these expenses, and we still got to share all this money with the Wyomings and the Colorado States and whoever else. They don't get into that side of it. Why else would it be doomed and facing bankruptcy? Didn't they just sign a multi-billion dollar TV deal for the college football playoff? I think they're in good shape. By the way, somebody helping them on this? One of Roger Goodell's top lieutenants, they call him. This sounds like the military. One of Roger Goodell from the NFL, one of his top lieutenants, is helping devise this Super League with college presidents and executives. 80 teams. Thanks for calling. You're live today, and you go ahead.
Hey, Nate. How you doing, buddy?
Good, man. What's up?
Hey, ever since NIL started happening, this is inevitable. Like, it was going to happen. Like, once you start paying amateur players, it's going to become a minor league. Like, that's...
Yeah, good
there's
point.
There's no
good
other
point.
Way around it.
It's the... this will be the semi-pro league. This will be...
Yeah.
The feeder league. And then what happens to everyone else? I don't know.
Right. Well, and the sad thing is all these major schools where football is the main revenue earner for the school, like none of that money, well, I don't know. They may have a plan for that, but
yeah,
what's
going
to happen
go?
To all the other
yeah.
extracurriculars?
Yes.
So when you start paying players, this is what happens. And whatever, they may earn it, and we got to change and get with the times, but it was always going to happen.
Good point, buddy. I appreciate
it.
Thanks for getting in. McJudgerson coming in on this. Listener text coming in here. 80 teams is way too many. What would the league be called? Maybe the Evil Empire? what are you guys going to do? I'm a college football fan, okay, as it is right now, okay? I'm a college football fan. I like the Big Ten. Watching the Huskers and Ohio State and all of that, and I'm a Mountain West fan. And yes, I like watching Wyoming and Utah State. Okay? So to me as a college football fan, am I going to, I'm not going to watch the Super League. Well, I'm going to watch the Super League. I'm going to watch the Super League. I'm not going to be happy. My question is, will I even be able to be as engaged with the Wyomings, the Mountain West, whoever? Where do they get their money? That's what I'm saying. They're all lumped into a lot of these TV deals now. They get a cut of some of this stuff. Do they have enough money or attraction to be signing media deals with CBS Sports Network or whoever? If they're in another category, that's my question. We got the Super League's going to get all the TV deals. Is there going to be somebody, we'll cover the Mountain West and and this team? Or will it be, here's a league, and now the FCS is the one that's out the window? Now the South Dakota States and the North Dakota States, they've got to join this next level. Is that how it's going to work? Is the Mountain West still going to be viable, but the FCS is not? Is it a domino effect? 80 teams, Super League, and they're doing it because the current system is doomed. So scary. Well, we're doomed if we have to keep sharing all of this money, and why would we want to do that? Dan Swartos in next, Executive Director of the South Dakota High School Activities Association. A lot of questions on high school sports. The ADs just met. We'll get into it next.
This is South Dakota's sports talk show, The Nate Brown Show, on FoxSportsRapidCity.com and live on 106.7 FM and 1150 AM, Fox Sports Rapid City.
The wait is over. Ensemble entry doors exclusively from Renewal by Anderson have arrived with an incredible offer. Secure, timeless style, elegant features, customized countless ways with the legendary quality of Renewal by Anderson. Right now, you get 20% off every Ensemble entry door. No money down, no interest, and no payments for 12 months. No payments for a year. Please scan the QR code on your screen or visit rbarapidcity.com now to book your free estimate. Ensemble entry doors, the wait is over.
We are number one, so you can always be their number one. Black Hills Surgical Hospital and Black Hills Orthopedic and Spine Center, the number one hospital in the nation for major orthopedic surgery.
Get up to $100 instant savings. Save $70 when you purchase four eligible Bridgestone tires or $60 when you purchase four eligible Firestone tires. Plus, get $30 off when your purchase is made on your Pomps Tire Service credit card. Wait, there's more! Purchase four eligible tires and save an additional $40 off installation. Hurry! Offers end April 30th. Pomps, we know tires and service. You should know Pomps. Subject to credit approval. See store for complete details or visit PompsTire.com.
Here's your Fox Sports Rapid City forecast. Lows dip down to about 36 tonight under mainly clear skies, south winds 5 to 10 miles per hour. Tomorrow, highs around 65. 40 tomorrow night, partly cloudy. Temperatures a bit above average Friday and Saturday with highs from the upper 50s to the mid 60s. Isolated rain showers likely Saturday. That's your forecast on the Black Hills Sports Station, Fox Sports Rapid City. Right now, it's 60 degrees.
If you want the peace of mind that your next pre-owned vehicle is the best it can be, you want Honda True. And you only find it at Danny Manholt Rushmore Honda. Our Honda certified pre-owned vehicles are thoroughly inspected and backed by 7-year 100,000-mile powertrain coverage, up to 2 complimentary oil changes, 24/7 roadside assistance, inspection report, and 3-day exchange. You simply can't buy the wrong vehicle. Search our inventory at honda-true.com or see us at Danny Manholt Rushmore Honda.
Live from the Anytime Auto Sales Service and Details Studio, sales, service, and recreation, this is Fox Sports Rapid City.
Hey, welcome back in. The Nate Brown Show live, Fox Sports Rapid City, 106.7 FM, 1150 AM, FoxSportsRapidCity.com. Live stream us right there. Also bring us up on Twitter at Nate Brown Show. Follow us on Twitter. Watch the show live 4 to 6 on Twitter at Nate Brown Show. Dan Swartos joining us live, South Dakota High School Activities Association Executive Director, and he's here on South Dakota Sports Talk Show. Dan, always good to have you. Thanks for coming on. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it.
Well, here we go. I wanted to have you on, talk about a few things. First, let's go to some crowds from our state tournaments. The Class B girls out here in Rapid City had good numbers, surpassed your expectations when it comes to a budget. So you had to be happy about that. Do you know how the A boys did out here in Rapid City yet?
They were about right on budget. It was about 150, which is what we were what we were expecting out there, and we're very happy with that. The A boys did really well.
Okay, I'll ask you one more. Double A girls, they go to the Pentagon. Some people talk about that. Hey, should they be in the big arena? But then I hear, well, the Pentagon's been so great, and a lot of the players and coaches I talk to, they love it. What about Double A girls?
I don't know. I haven't seen the settlement for that one yet, but yeah, the Pentagon has been fantastic. I think the kids love going there. They have a lot of bells and whistles, and they really do it up for the kids. And I think the kids that have played in there have really loved it. But I haven't seen a settlement for that. I know the A girls at the Dakota Bank Center in Brookings, that was a very good crowd as well. And that one was over our budget. I can't remember the numbers off the top of my head, but that one was higher than what we're used to for A girls.
Really?
Okay. Really happy for that. Normally, you know, in Brookings, we're at Frost Arena, but they're renovating, so we were at the old Swift-Tail Center, which is now the Dakota Bank Center, and did really well there. And that was size-wise, did pretty well. There were some issues with getting people in and out and transitioning between games, but we're really happy with how that went at the Dakota Bank Center.
Overall, is it still everybody's thought that having these tournaments in various locations is still working out?
I think so. I mean, we get the question all the time about combining them. You know, my answer is, we're a membership, and we're driven by our schools, and our schools haven't ever really come to us with desire to put them all in one place. I would agree that it might be better for the viewer or the people watching it who want to watch all three, but you know, our schools themselves have enjoyed having their own space there, and it would also involve, you know, probably playing it down to four final four type thing, just for logistics. And our schools haven't really showed a desire to do that either. So, I mean, for now, I think that, you know, the message we've gotten from our schools is that they like how we're doing it now and haven't really pushed us to do much different.
Dan Swartos on tonight, Executive Director for the Activities Association in Pierre. So I want to go to this AD meeting. There was a lot of stuff that was discussed, so I just want to see if we have an update. One is basketball hosting Class A and Class B SODAC 16 games, where they've been at neutral sites. They were going to look at it and say, should SODAC 16 host at the high seeds like AA does? So, what was decided there, A and B?
Well, that was kind of pushed by volleyball. Volleyball had the same thing, and we had thought that, well, if volleyball's going to do it, we should look at it for basketball as well. And, you know, there wasn't, our schools weren't, I don't think, well, we haven't gotten the vote yet, but the straw poll was that our schools were not ready to do that yet. And I think there's, particularly for basketball, there's a lot of concern there about facility size for the gym size for the crowds that we get for some of those games. And, you know, we had that, like the Pine Ridge Eagle Butte, China Eagle Butte game we had. We put that in Douglas and still ended up with 100-plus people that couldn't get them in, and we ended up, they played it out on some screens in the cafeteria. So you get into some, particularly some B schools, those are some pretty small venues, and I think there was a lot of concern about that and size and how you ensure that, you know, people, or even like a St. Thomas More that has a pretty small, a smaller gym, you know, to host it in there might be some issues in terms of making sure that the visiting crowd also has some seats. So I think there was concerns on that. From our end, we wanted schools to at least look at it because it can get really tough to try to find a neutral site that's closer to the higher seed when you've got, you know, say you've got Chester and Timberlake. You know, there's not a whole lot of places in the middle closer to Chester who also aren't in playing somewhere else and are willing to host. So it gets a little tough to find those sites, but we're just going to have to keep working at it.
Okay, that's interesting. I've always wondered kind of what the argument was. Why can't Class A and Class B – host at the high seed like AA. And so you're saying the big one really is maybe the venue and these smaller schools saying, boy, we're going to get a big, big crowd, and we don't necessarily be able to handle that.
Yeah, and, you know, we had put part of the proposal was that it had to seat at least 700 people, I think, and the ceilings needed to be a certain height. And if it wasn't, then the host site needed to find an alternative site that was no further for the visiting team to travel to. Mm. But I think that was the biggest thing is we've got a lot of gyms that seat 700-800 people, and for those games to get to the state tournament, you had a lot of people there, and I think there was some concern about, you know, sort of being set up for failure. Although the atmosphere would be fantastic, and, you know, people hanging from the rafters, you know, the last thing we want is Grandma and Grandpa can't get in or something like that. So, you know, they wanted to keep doing what we're doing.
Dan Suartos on tonight. Appreciate his time. Executive Director for the Activities Association with an update on high school sports from the AD meeting. I think this was going to be thrown around. Go over to football. 9-man playoff picture. We've had 16 teams. There was a discussion to go to 12. Did that go anywhere?
No, I don't. Well, like I said, we haven't gotten the official votes back yet, but the straw poll we took there was it was opposed to that. I think that's something we need to continue to look at. A lot of those games are not competitive, and you've got teams that travel quite a long ways and they end up getting beat in playing a half and getting beat by 50 points and driving home. I think there's some concern about what, you know, those top four seeds would have a bye, and if they had a bye in week, their last regular season week, then you're looking at 2 weeks of bye weeks, and I understand that as well. But the straw poll that we had on that was against it.
And I look at it, is that the AD/coaches saying, hey, we like playing in the playoffs. Kids want to play in the playoffs, so let's keep 16 teams in.
Yeah, I think so. And I could see it from that perspective as well. You know, a lot of times the superintendents and the coaches look at it differently than the coaches and the athletic directors look at it differently than the superintendents and business managers when they're talking about, you know, paying for busing to drive across the state for one of those games. And I understand both sides of that. And, you know, it was something that came through. If we're going to stay at three classes for 9-man, which we are, that we should look at reducing that down to 12. And from what I saw in the straw poll, I don't think it's going to pass.
Okay, let me get into this, because you guys discussed it, Dan, and I think you've done a nice job with this, trying to create a policy, at least, of NIL. Okay, there's really not much on the books, and with all these states and all the NIL discussion, you're saying, okay, what's the policy going to be for South Dakota high school activities when it comes to name, image, and likeness at the high school level? First reading was passed, but that means that's got to go to a second reading, and if it passes there, then this would go to a vote of the schools, right, to have a name, image, and likeness policy. And they would have to get the school 60%.
That's correct.
So kind of explain, what do you feel like is the public feeling out there amongst right now when it comes to NIL? You're trying to have a policy, but is there a negative view of this?
Well, sure. I think there is, because, you know, quite frankly, the NCAA is kind of a mess with it right now. And, you know, what the approach I took was, right now our language says that a student's not able to receive remuneration for their name, image, and likeness as an athlete. And it's just one sentence. Well, it doesn't really define what as an athlete means. If I'm a running back on the football team, but I also have, you know, 100,000 followers on TikTok and I monetize that, am I receiving that money as a person, or am I receiving that money as an athlete? And so what I kind of looked at it as is, you know, if an accusation of this or if something like this came across my desk, what would I use, or what would I look at to determine, okay, are they doing this as just a regular old individual student, or are they doing this as an athlete? So it's just trying to delineate that and saying, you know, you're not using your school facilities, you're not wearing school uniforms, you're not using school logos, you're not standing there with the state championship trophy in front of you. You're purely doing this as an individual. And, you know, we've probably got kids some kids in the state probably with some rather high social media followings, and if they were to monetize those, that's where I think we run into this. And, you know, I've had some parents sort of beating on our door about this, and they've got kids who have opportunities for this, and we're probably talking about a pretty small number of kids. But Lincoln Keenholz, you know, I'm sure he had all sorts of opportunities in high school, and, you know, all we said is you're not allowed to do that. All our current language says is you're not allowed to do this as an athlete, and that's literally all it says. So this is trying to put some guardrails up, and so kids know, for one, and they're not yet. The last thing I want to do is to take a kid's amateur status away because of some vague language that we have in our policy manual. Mm. So it's putting something out there for the kids to say, you know, this is what we would consider earning money as an athlete. It's not pay to play. It's not tied to attendance at any school. It's not involving your school facilities, or you're not wearing your school uniforms. You're doing it on your own.
But
the other side of that is we've got kids who are musicians and participate in all state band or jazz band who gig with bands on the weekends all the time and get paid for that. But we've always sort of treated the athletic side of it differently. So we're just trying to navigate through there. And I get it. I mean, I'm sure there's people that are uncomfortable with it, and I'm uncomfortable with it too, just because it's sort of turned into the Wild West on the collegiate front. But I think we're talking about a much smaller segment of kids here where this would impact, and just trying to make sure that if nothing else, that kids and families know this is, if we're looking at this, this is what we would be looking at to see if you violated the policy or not.
So I'm a girls basketball player and I got a good following. I want to do a day clinic and I want to charge $25 and I'm going to do first through third graders and I'm going to do a camp for them. This would allow me to do that if I'm not wearing my Stevens jersey. I'm not using the Stevens school.
I think kids are allowed to do that now. We've got kids that put on youth camps in the summer all the time.
Okay.
If that kid did a commercial for a local car wash, and it's the difference of that student doing that commercial from their football field, or that student just doing it in a studio somewhere wearing normal clothes as opposed to their football jersey and identifying themselves by their name instead of I'm Stevens quarterback.
Okay.
Joe Smith, and just trying to delineate that to say you're doing this as an individual and you're not doing it as an athlete.
Interesting. So NIL second reading would have to pass, and then that would go to the schools, and you'd have to get 60% to vote for that to change that.
Correct.
We'll keep an eye on that as that comes back up. Last one for Dan Sortos, and I'll let you run, Dan. I appreciate the time. It's sure. That time of year. High school baseball starting up. Okay. High school softball's going. It's sanctioned. High school baseball discussion still being thrown around. Will that ever come to fruition?
Well, the problem was we had never had a policy in the past. And here's how you add a sport. So we passed a policy last year, and now we do have requests from two different schools for us to begin that process, which would be a study of it, just to, you know, to get financials of it. Here's when the season would be, here's when the championship would be, just sort of the parameters of it. And so I do believe we'll be starting the process of looking at that. Yes.
Very interesting. I know that's been thrown around a lot of club baseball teams.
But we're probably looking at a year or two before it would, you know, probably the next classification cycle before it would he would come and do at least a year, but probably the next classification cycle before it would come to fruition.
Would schools have to vote on that too?
No, our board votes on that, and then the schools have the option locally if they want to sanction it or not.
Very interesting. Good stuff and a great update. Dan Swartos on tonight, Executive Director for the Activities Association in Pier. Dan, always appreciate the insight. Thanks for your time.
Hey, thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Dan Swartos tonight, live, South Dakota High School Activities Association Executive Director. Great update. Good insight. Good info. The ADs just had a meeting, went over some stuff, and we'll see where things go. And you just heard him say a couple of schools want the process to start of sanctioning high school baseball. Sanctioning high school baseball. There's got to be a look at it, a process, and he said the board would have to vote on that, and he doesn't expect anything to happen at least for a couple of years by the next go-around. But it really hasn't gone that far yet. And so a couple of schools say, hey, let's look at doing this. So they're going to look at it. Then South Dakota would join the ranks potentially of having sanctioned high school baseball. A lot of high school baseball club teams, I think the last check I had was just over 50. So there's a lot of teams schools would have to decide, just like they did with softball. Are we going to play? Are we not going to play? So, by the way, we've tried playing softball. It's been a little wet, a little cold, a little wet, and a little bit nicer now. We'll try and get some games in. Dan Swartos on tonight. Let's go to my next topic here. I threw out a question. Do you have more interest in high school sports or college sports? I'm not talking about if you're a Husker fan and that passion. I'm talking about in South Dakota. When it comes to South Dakota sports coverage, are you more into high school or college? The Hard Rockers, the Yellow Jackets, the Jacks, the Yotes. Which way would you answer that? I've got a poll. People answered it. And then I've got something that doesn't quite work next.
Live callers, big-time interviews, and breaking sports news. This is the Nate Brown Show on Fox Sports Rapid City.
Spring has sprung and riding season has officially begun at Black Hills Harley-Davidson. Find your perfect next ride with our huge selection of new and pre-owned Harley-Davidsons. You can buy a 2014 Road King for only $13,995. Or how about a 2019 Heritage 114 for only $15,995? We are stocked to the brim with a newly redesigned 2024 Street Glide and Road Glide models. And now is the perfect time to get your summer ride. Come shop Black Hills Harley-Davidson off I-90 exit 55 or online at blackhillshd.com.
Looking for a career? Look no further. Pete Lean & Sons has immediate openings for ready-mix concrete delivery drivers. No CDL? No problem. We offer paid training, competitive hourly rates, and full-time hours. Plus, Pete Lean & Sons offers excellent benefits, including a low-deductible health insurance plan and a 401k with a generous company match. At Pete Lean & Sons, team members can also grow and develop their trade while supporting local communities. These are all reasons why employees hired at Pete Lean & Sons want to retire at Pete Lean & Sons. Apply now at PeteLean.com.
The Horseshoe Restaurant at First Gold in Deadwood makes dining out delicious and affordable. Every Wednesday from 11 till 8 p.m., enjoy traditional wings for $1 or boneless wings for 50 cents, served with your pick of 12 different sauces. Thursday, it's 2 for $20 burger night. Big and fresh burgers with your choice of side. The Horseshoe Restaurant proudly serves breakfast all day. And from 7 a.m. till 1 p.m., you can add one giant homemade pancake to your meal for only $2.99. The Horseshoe Restaurant at First Gold Gaming Resort in Deadwood.
Calling all cornhole players, the American Cornhole Organization is bringing their Majors Tournament to the Black Hills. Throw some bags at the Box Elder Event Center on April 26th and 27th and compete in the ACO Black Hills Major. Whether you're a seasoned pro or new to the game, this event's perfect for everyone. Join the opening reception April 25th with a cash prize of its own to win. Get registered at thebox.live. From gatherings to games, think inside the box.
So, I just got the State Farm Personal Price Plan on my car insurance.
So you told your agent you play the bagpipes for your dog?
What? No, I didn't get that personal. My agent just helped me create an affordable price just for me. Okay, let me show you what I've been working on. Hey, Buster!
Contact me, State Farm Agent Scott Carlson, to create your personal price plan today.
Prices vary by state. Options selected by customer. Availability and eligibility may vary.
Hey, this is Rob Parker from The Odd Couple. Don't miss our show weeknights from 6 to 8 p.m. right here on Fox Sports Rapid City. And now we'll send you back to Rapid City Sports Talk Show, the Nate Brown Show.
Welcome back in, South Dakota Sports Talk Show, the Nate Brown Show, driven by Spearfish Motors. When it comes to the new 2024 GMCs and Cadillacs in the Black Hills, it's Spearfish GMC Cadillac. 1910 North Main in Spearfish. Look for the big American flag, so you got them, right? Then Roger and the crew, they'll set you up. Locally owned new car and truck dealership. Not many of those left. That matters. Start at spearfishmotors.com. New 2024 models, Cadillacs. The Cadillac Escalade, GMC Sierra pickups, the Terrain, the Yukons, they're all there. Spearfishmotors.com. We are professional grade. Okay, I have a question here because in light of the news that happened last week in South Dakota sports coverage, I talked about this, Midco Sports in Sioux Falls has decided to lay off 13 announcers. So I know some of these folks, and they've done an outstanding job really covering all aspects of sports and a lot of high school coverage, which I've appreciated it. Live games, live shows. I've went on Varsity Live now. It's a scoreboard show. I used to go on that, Midco Sports, do some high school reports back in the day. And Midco Sports is getting rid of all of that high school coverage. They say they're going to focus on streaming and their college partnerships, which I understand. There's big coverage back East River, USD, SDSU, Augie. I mean, the whole thing. So they're going to focus on the college aspect. And I've always thought here on this show, what we try doing almost every day, local, regional, national. We try and put it together every day because I get not everybody's into the local. Not everybody's a Husker fan. Not everybody wants to hear the same thing over and over about Stephon Diggs all day. Okay, so you try and get something that people are engaged in and find interesting from high school to college to the pros. I mean, we try and do that. So I get it. You can't just be boxed in. But I've always wondered, in South Dakota sports, when I'm talking to a sports fan tonight, what is most interesting to you? What coverage do you want the most in South Dakota sports? Well, like from a sports radio show like this or a media company. Is Midco Sports bailing on high school sports the right play? That's what I really want to know because I look at it. High school sports to me in South Dakota is still really special. There's a connection that people have. Usually maybe they played for the school. Their kids are playing. They're engaged. I still see people that don't have kids playing here in town. They go into the games. I mean, they've gone to the games for years. So I still think they're special, South Dakota high school sports. College is great, and we have some great coverage of college stories and universities and SDSU and the whole thing. But I've always wondered, what do you want more of, high school or college? In South Dakota, that's all. When it comes to local to regional South Dakota sports coverage, what are you most interested in? So this isn't I want to hear a Husker update every day. We give you one anyway. But, it's not that. Not Huskers. I'm passion there. I'm talking South Dakota. So I threw it out. What do you think the poll results are? Here it is. 66% voting for high school tonight. When it comes to South Dakota sports coverage, what are you most interested in, high school or college? 66% high school, 34% college. Very, very interesting. Take that and run with it. I don't know, 66% say high school, and it's just a snapshot, just one snapshot on our poll on Twitter. And I got to say, what's been my experience? Usually when we do some high school stuff, maybe it's a high school interview, high school coach, you know, talking high school topics like football classes for the 90th time. When we do high school stuff, usually on social media, on our digital side, that gets more play than my college stuff. I mean, it just does. So take it for what it's worth. And what I'm telling you is we're going to stay dialed in on it. Not leaving the pros and the college to everyone else. I mean, you got to stay regional. You got to stay engaged with some major stories like South Dakota State coming out to Rapid City and that whole thing. That's big. But you got to stay dialed in on the high school side. I still believe there's a big, big marketplace for great South Dakota high school coverage. Midco Sports going to get out of it. And I don't think that's a great play. Who's hot and who's not is next. As a matter of fact, do we have time? Let's do it right now. Let's do it right now. We're live. Okay, let's do it right now. Who's hot and who's not as we wrap up the Wednesday show brought to you by the Pizza Ranch. My friends at the Pizza Ranch, locally owned and operated, two locations, best buffet, you know that, Pizza Ranch Buffet here in Rapid City. Pizza Ranch, who's hot and who's not. Tonight, in my who's hot category, I'm going to go out to Yankton. This is a great story. Yankton officially has a Paralympics qualifier. Miles Krajewski. Miles Krajewski and his doubles partner named to the mixed doubles fields. J.C. Simon is his doubles partner. They're going to be in the Paris 2024 Paralympics. Unbelievable. He's going to compete in the men's singles as well. Badminton. Badminton is the sport. Hey, whenever you hit the big time, and it's Yankton tonight with a Paralympics qualifier. I love it. In badminton. Okay, in our Pizza Ranch, who's not tonight? You know how we talk about the transfer portal. How about this update? I told you Zeke Mayo from South Dakota State's going to Kansas. That's big time. How many men's basketball players from the Summit League are in the transfer portal today? How many do you think? 39. Okay. 39 men's basketball players in the transfer portal today. How many players have found a new home? 3. That's it. 39 players in the transfer portal. 3 have found a new home. Maybe they will. But I'm always telling you, it's not always roses. Not always roses. You go to the transfer portal, I'm going to find a spot. 39 men's Summit League players in, 3 have found a team. Back tomorrow on the Nate Brown Show. See you back here at 4. Thanks for listening. The Nate Brown Show podcast. You can download it, search for it. It's going up right now, and The Odd Couple is on.
57-51, 4 minutes to go in the second quarter.